Hello, good evening. Thank you all for coming. And I would like to first of all introduce myself. My name is Naomi. I'm the new director and curator of the gallery. And I'm very happy to present this show, Salvatore Emblema, Chagnon-Burke. This panel will discuss mixing in Italian cultural art, Salvatore Emblema. And our panelist today is Amnon, an independent curator and art historian. He came straight from Tel Aviv and has worked with Emblema during... What year did you work with Emblema? What year did you work with Emblema?
Yeah. I met him in 1981. I was in Rome. He was in this Terzino, which means Pompeii. And then I created a Museum of Contemporary Art in Paro, Firenze, and then we went to Attaché some years ago with the
Panelists. Thank you. Alma Ruiz is a senior curator at MOCA Los Angeles. Véronique, Chagnon-Burke, academic at Christie, education in New York. And Renato, Miracco is an art critic, curator, and cultural attaché at the Italian Embassy in Washington, D.C. So, I would also like to say that today with us is Emanuele Leon Emblema, is the curator of the Museum Emblema in Italy. And I'm sure he will, yeah, raise your hands. So, hi. Any additional questions you want to ask him? He's an amazing source of information. He's just the best person to talk to for any specific questions or general questions about Emblema's work. So let's start. Alma, we will start with you. That's okay.
Okay.
Okay. So we will start by talking about the late revolution of Italian post-war art in general.
Thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this panel. Just a little background, about maybe not 2 years earlier that we met, perhaps. Before that, I did not know about Salvatore Emblema. You know, I had a certain connection to Italy for many years and have worked with Italian artists, especially contemporary artists and all. But I had never encountered the work of Emblema. Until I met Emanuele and he introduced me to it. And I have visited the foundation a couple of times. I've been to Naples and have looked at a lot of the work in person and also a lot of digital images. And it's interesting to see how artists like Emblema sort of, in a way, fall through the cracks. Artists who do not make it into the regular, you know, history of art of a country or even a continent or the universal history of art. And, you know, it's always fascinated me. I might have always asked myself, why? Why is it that this artist who is so good, you know, is not well known and comes over and over and over? So I understand that, of course, you know, there are circumstances and that not everyone can be, you know, as well known as the artist next door. But it's also interesting that we find ourselves at a time in which we are also very much more open to getting to know artists, to evaluate artists from all over the world, you know, with the advent of globalism perhaps. You know, curators especially, I think curators are opening themselves up to see art from other countries. I can see it with my colleagues in Los Angeles, you know, where they were trained with this kind of European American access. And not always very open to that as well. Maybe it's the US and Germany, or the US and another, you know, France. So even within that, many curators are very restricted in their viewing, in their curiosity, and again, so there are artists like Emblema who should occupy a certain very important place, not just in the history of Italy, but in the history of art in general. and they donate it. So I hope that with the efforts that are being done today, that you know these kind of panels will, in a way, open become the starting point or the launching point for artists like Emblema. That there will be, I hope, young curators or students who are interested in the work and will look at it and will study it and write about it or analyze it and in a way bring it into the discussion, you know, of art today. So, you know, in looking at this kind of late revaluation, it's something that I, it's not late because we're always reevaluating in a way, especially I was looking at the presence of Italian art in the US because that's what we're discussing here. And it was interesting to see that, you know, first of all, it's been galleries that have taken the lead, not necessarily museums, in presenting artists, you know, from other countries or cultures. And the very early, in 1950 actually, the Catherine Viviano Gallery in New York organized an exhibition called Five Italian Painters. And that is the earliest that I found in terms of the American gallery inviting a group of Italian artists to show. The artists who were invited were Afro, Renato Giusso, Gaglieri, Ennio Morlotti, Armando Pizzinato. And interesting enough that among those, it was Afro and Giusso maybe the ones that sort of struck a chord here, and they started to show in the US. Afro quite often. That same year he got a white person show in that gallery. And then he continued to be invited. And again, you can see the pattern that once, you know, someone meets the artist or gives the person a show, the name stays in their mind. And so when they decide to do exhibitions or when they talk about it, they always bring this artist. So at some point, you know, in 53, for example, Alberto Burri, shows, not in New York, but in Chicago, at the Firm King Gallery. And it's, from then on, you know, it's like, Burri starts showing all over the place, and he continues to show quite extensively until 1991, and then somehow things stop a little bit there. But you can see that once these names start floating around and people start becoming familiar with them, so they are repeated, and it's good and it's bad. And it's good because these artists get opportunities, you know, and they can present the work on a regular basis, but it's bad because it's the same names that keep appearing and reappearing and reappearing. And so it's like we feel comfortable with what we know, and we don't see beyond that. And so for the artists who are in the part of the system, you know, it's positive for them, for the ones who remain out of the system, then it makes it even harder to get in it. In a way, Italian art in the U.S. has had a very strong presence, you know, for the last 16 years. As I said, it started in 1950. Once the galleries began showing the artist, the museums got into it, but one of the New York museums that began to show them right away was the Guggenheim. And it could have been because of the Guggenheim, you know, connection to Italy. But they did actually in 53, they did an exhibition called Younger European Painters, you know, and Burri and Capogrossi were part of that. And the Guggenheim regularly included them in this international award that they had set up initially. In addition to the artists that I have mentioned, like Burri and Capogrossi and Afro, there were others like Turcato and San Tommaso that were also included in this. Castellani in 1864 was included, and of course Lucio Fontana. And Lucio Fontana showed quite a bit here as well. So I think that what to say, we evaluated Italian art, we've been doing that for 60 years. It's a little interesting. And of course, you know, the presence of Italians with galleries in New York, like Salvatore Alla or Enzo Speroni, were also crucial in bringing these artists here as well. That perhaps hasn't been given enough credit. credit is Piero Durazio. He came to the US, you know, he attended seminars at Harvard. I think he taught in the US, he had a residency at Men's College in Oakland. But the interesting thing that I found out about Piero Durazio at some point is that in 1963, he and another Italian, Angelo Savello, with students from the University of Pennsylvania, established the ICA, the Institute of Contemporary Art. And you know, the Institute of Contemporary Art in Philadelphia is about a very important place. So it's thanks to artists like Piero Durazio, you know, and Angelo Savello, that that place exists today. And I'm also interested in bringing these hidden histories and making them more public, because I think it is important to give to people that have done such important done such important contributions to the history of art, to the history of art in America. And you know, in addition to the Guggenheim that I have mentioned, there's been also MoMA that at some point, you know, started to include these artists as well. And perhaps one of the exhibitions that, you know, happened in the 60s that was really important, in which a good number of Italian artists participated, was The Responsive Eye, you know, the exhibition in which the curator of that exhibition basically invents the word of art, you know. So here we have artists that perhaps, you know, not many people remember, like Tullio Aldiani. You know, there is a collection in Santa Barbara, California that I saw about 2 years ago, and apparently there's a Tullio Aldiani in the collection. And I was very surprised to find him there, and he was the first artist that this particular collector bought. And he had a kinetic collection, and Getulio Biani was the first artist, and then from then he continued to buy others. Another artist that, you know, participated in this was Alberto Biasi. Of course, Enrico Castellani, whom we know very well. Giovanni Antonio Costa, Piero Durazio was there. Enzo Mari was another artist. And interesting, this exhibition, you know, which also had a large number of artists from Latin America, traveled to St. Louis, to Seattle, Pasadena, California, and Baltimore. So it was an exhibition that was seen by a tremendous number of people. Artists like Burri, for example, who have been shown extensively in the US and actually lived in Los Angeles, because he's a very American woman and he used to spend half of the year there in seclusion because nobody knew. Nobody knew, people would go to Italy to meet with him, and he was two blocks away. But it was so interesting, you know, that artists like Burri or Pistoletto, who got his first solo show at the Walker Art Center in 1966, and others became really, some of them had this kind of flourishing at the beginning and then sort of stopped showing in the US. But the Italian presence in the US, was very important here, but there was also an American presence in Italy. And artists from the US started to show in Rome and other places, artists like Robert Rauschenberg, who had a presence, Dan Flavin, Jim Dine, Warhol, etc. So in a way, there was this exchange between America and Italy for a long, long time. For curators, I think, most recently, there have been some important exhibitions about Italian artists. Richard Flood, you know, I think he's still with the new museum. Former curator of the Walker, when he was there, he actually organized a very important exhibition called Zero to Infinity, Art Deco, 1962-1972, with Francis Morris from the Tate. And that was in 2002, but this exhibition sort of gave Art Deco a new, and kind of pushed it to a new level in the US. Richard Flood had worked for Barbara Gladstone, and Barbara Gladstone is the galleries that has championed Art Deco for a long, long time. And especially artists like Alighiero Boetti, and more recently, Mario Benz, Marisa Metz, and Melotti, Fausto Melotti as well. But he basically learned about Art Deco exhibition, which then traveled to the museum that I worked for the following year. And for me, Los Angeles was a really interesting experience because there, the artists didn't know about Art de Bóveda. The artists who taught in universities didn't know about Art de Bóveda. And so it was kind of interesting to find out how a movement as important as Art de Bóveda is sometimes excluded, you know, from the history of art, and so young artists do not know about. And but it's shows like this that happened, you know, every few years that really help. Because curiously, 2 years ago, I co-organized an exhibition of Miguel Boetti's embroideries for the Fowler Museum at UCLA in Los Angeles. And the co-curator was a young man who's now at one of the universities here on the East Coast. And he actually discovered Art de Bóveda in 2002 by going to MOCA, you know, and seeing Richard Blood's exhibition. And now he is, you know, a scholar of Art de Bóveda. He's writing about it and he's creating exhibitions of Boetti. So, you know, it's interesting to see how things happen, you know, and how you encounter, you know, these situations open. And with Alighieri Boetti having a retrospective recently, you know, and that is a name that's circulated so much, but still in California, you know, people don't know Alighieri Boetti. Only two Boetti exhibitions that have taken place in Los Angeles. One has been at MOCA in 1994, where I actually presented Alighieri's last project, alternating from 1 to 100 and vice versa. And then came to MOCA in August of 94, so about 4 or 5 months after Alighieri Boetti passed away. That was the last exhibition he did in France and then came to Los Angeles. And then 2 years ago, you know, the Alighieri Boetti and the Afghan women, which represented a whole series of photographs of the women who used to embroider all the work of Boetti in Peshawar, Pakistan. So we can continue to do this, we can continue to make an effort in presenting, you know, what we consider important artists who should be part of this dialogue. And I think that, you know, with Emblema, it's a new opportunity. I think that in getting to know the work and in having panels like these, we can then, we can look at the work, we can evaluate it, we can place it within the history that it belongs to. And he's an interesting artist because he touches upon, you know, many of the movements without having belonged to any of them. You know, he can be associated in the use of materials. Maybe there's a connection there with COVID, you know, the use of the burlap, you know, and he said, yes, of transparency could be connected to the lighting space movement. You know, in California, for example, paintings can be also connected to abstract expressionism. He spent 2 years in the U.S. from 56 to 58. He frequented Mark Rothko. You know, he was very aware of what was going on here. You know, when he worked in Rome, he was very connected to the cinema as well, having worked with Cina Città and so on. So I think that his work can be read in so many different levels and can be looked at in so many different ways. And as we look at the work, we can even discover more, and you know, and it's not necessarily to place him within a movement, but it's really certainly important to place him within the history, you know, of art as a relevant artist, you know. And I hope that younger art, younger curators and younger historians, you know, will be able to look at it with fresh eyes, which I think is really important, you know, and get more people to talk about the work because then more ideas come up and make the work look a lot more interesting. So I'm going to stop there and then allow other
greats. I should answer my second question in terms of this place and movement, and I would like to address this question also to Renato Miracco in terms of what is Emblema's place in movements such as informale, contemporary, or minimalism, abstract expressionism, or other movements that you find, because we were talking about that yesterday, would be interesting to hear what you say.
Yeah, thank you. Good for inviting me and just for the time. I would like to point out how was my career related with the 1950 movement in Italy. I was assistant at what Achille Bonito did at the university in 1850 paintings. And I had just the chance to curate so many exhibitions about futurism. and then a Tate Modern when I was just a guest curator at Tate Modern. I just did just the Burri and Fontana and Manzoni exhibition at Tate Modern too. And then I was curator for 7 years of the Estuary Collection in London. And then I moved to the Metropolitan for Morani exhibition. So I all the moment, all the current, all the field, all the humus of that moment is really familiar with me. And then I really had a chance just to meet when I was really kids, like it was really impressed with me. Tony Fontana, for example, and before he died, I had a long conversation with Rauschenberg. And I was really thinking about just curating an exhibition about the fluxes between Italian in America and American in Italy. In the same time, Argan wrote just an essay about Emblema. We wrote, before he died, I'm sorry, we wrote just a book together about what happened. So this is the background of my idea of, so I really, as you say, Alma, I'm really following you in this idea, not to talk about Emblema, but just try to include Emblema in just in Italian code, you know what I mean? So, I would like to read a few sentences, to quote a few sentences, starting from Petroni. We are talking about 1911. So now paintings has to be just a bridge between external infinity and internal infinity. So this will be just the start of a new gulf between what the artists are looking for. For a new dimension, so the canvas can be just another idea, not the idea of the reproduction of the reality. And Manzoni, when he was just 23 years old, was attending just the academy in Milan, say, why the painting has to be related with the canvas? Canvas is just a moment, it's just a step. Who cares about this one? And the other one is, we are talking about light, so the discovery of light into paintings. So the paintings have just only just a step between here and a new dimension. I really would like just to underline how was the discovery of the fourth dimension, starting from 1913. So this is exactly the idea of canvas and the idea of paintings. And I was so glad that Alma mentioned that the first exhibition was 1948 at Peggy Guggenheim, followed by another exhibition in 1955, but in the same times, the Emil Torini in 1941, underlines the relationship between Italy and America. And America is, or I quote, America is no longer America, no longer the new world, is the world world. So when I had just a conversation with Rauschenberg and the same time as a conversation with Afro, the relationship between Italy and America was really amazing. Afro, with just incredible exhibition in the gallery, and then following that, then he was starting just to work with the university. So just enter just an idea, the new idea of the culture, the new idea of transformation of the paintings. And what we are looking for, Rauschenberg, we had just a little conversation about just like to report, what the American artists are looking for in Italy and what the Italian artists are looking for in America. And it was really amazing because Rauschenberg said, we were looking for history. Mm-hmm. No? So, and this is exactly the same sentences of Rothko, saying to Emblema, why are you coming here? You have just Pompeii, you have just material, you have just such incredible things there. Why are you looking for here?
same time, Rush will say, and Alf will say again, we were looking for just a confirmation of our work. We didn't have been recognized in Italy as an artist, because we are really doing something totally, totally new for Italy. Italy is in that moment was really addicted to the past, more than addicted, and looking for the future. So I was looking for confirmation about my work. I was looking for money, for sure. And because that is the research of. And we were talking about Afro, for example. Afro shared his studio with the Kooning in Rome. Strongly married Franchetti. So this is all the environment, but exactly of the same moment. And so the new, so everybody in that moment can really discover the new material code. That is incredible. And Emblema is looking. So I'm not fascinated by transparency or whatever. No, I'm exactly. I know that you agree with me. Is transparency is just a step of a huge research, including in a huge research in that moment. That's exactly is the goal of that person.